Hello everyone and welcome to Inside Spurs here at Hotspur Way. I'm sure you've all barely had a chance to come back down off the ceiling from the weekend. What an incredible result and what an amazing atmosphere at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium. But very quickly, attention has to turn, doesn't it, to the North London Derby. How are your nerves? It always feels different on North London Derby weekend, doesn't it? But don't worry, we've got you covered here with all of the build-up to the biggest game of the season so far on Inside Spurs. Hello everyone and welcome to Inside Spurs, a show where every week we'll give you the build-up to every single fixture. And what a fixture it is this weekend, the North London Derby, one of the biggest of the season. We're going to get stuck into all of the build-up and we're going to introduce our special guest very, very shortly. But first, here's what's coming up on the show. We're going to reflect on that late win against Sheffield United last weekend. What a performance and what a result. And how are you all feeling ahead of this weekend? We'll get the fans' view as we look forward to a huge game at the Emirates. And of course, we'll hear from Ange ahead of his first North London derby. But first, let's introduce today's guest, our club commentator, Rob Daly. Tell me, Rob, have you come down from the weekend yet?
No, to be honest. It was just one of the best games that we've had at the new stadium. You sort of had that buzz running for a few days after, to be honest, watching the goal in every different incarnation, camera angle and language going. But, you know, what a game and what a great mood, vibe around the club at the moment going into the North London derby.
I can't wait to get stuck into last weekend, but I have got to ask you first. On North London derby week, how do you feel? So what side of the fence do you sit on? Because I'm always nervous, anxious, like panicky.
You're an emotional wreck most of the time.
But every North London derby, I'm always an absolute mess.
No, I'm prepping the game and looking at it from quite a clinical point of view, because that's kind of my job on the day, you know, to just sort of analyse what's happening and break down the numbers and everything. And I'm really excited for this game because I think Spurs are going to go there, play their way, bring that new style of football under Ange Postecoglou to Arsenal. And it's going to be a great indicator, unbeaten at the moment in the Premier League, of course, like Arsenal, as to where this team is so early in the Ange era.
Can I just say, I absolutely love the fact that we know, going into this weekend, that Spurs are going to play the way they've been playing all season. Nothing's going to change in terms of, like, right, we need to sit off or sit back. It will be a case of Ange wanting Spurs to go out and win the game.
Exactly. I don't think we're going to see like a dramatic tactical change. We're still going to want players to take on the ball in difficult positions on the half turn, back to goal, try and make things happen, get James Maddison in space to create and cause Arsenal problems. Arsenal try and doing exactly the same thing. They love to dominate the ball. So from a tactical point of view, it's going to be absolutely fascinating. And then you've got the atmosphere, the history of everything. It's the game of the season. And I think probably, Ben, like looking at what we've had, we're probably a month and a half into the new season. It's probably the biggest fixture of the Premier League season so far, I think. So
that's a great talk. That's why I'm nervous. It's all so much, isn't it? For fans, it's just one of those games. You just can't help it. You just know how much it means.
Yeah.
But look, let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. Let's go back to last weekend. How special was that as a result, as a performance, and as a way to win the game as well?
Yeah, I mean, in truth, you know, going into added time, even when 12 minutes came up on the fourth official's board, I thought the game was probably lost. It was a really difficult afternoon in that second half. Spurs created a host of chances, conceded from a set piece. It always was likely to be Sheffield United's best route to goal. Then, of course, you've got Ivan Perisic on the pitch. He's got that quality of delivery. Richarlison, a fantastic header of the ball as well. It's a brilliant finish from him. And, of course, then all those subs. And this was one of the most telling things, really, for me after the game. What a finish from Dejan Kulusevski, by the way, the one attacking player left on the pitch by Ange Postecoglou from the starting 11. The appreciation for Richarlison after his difficulties with Brazil came back. Goal, assist, basically helps win the game for Spurs. It was just, I mean, full-time was a really nice vibe as well. But the impact of the subs and Højbjerg, Perisic, Richarlison, all involved in those goals. Brennan Johnson having a goal marginally disallowed. There was so much to like about the manner of that late Leicester-esque comeback win.
I know that fans will have gone through this in microscopic detail, but from your vantage point, why don't you try and explain to me the full-time scenes and what it felt like and what was going on just in front of you when you looked around the stadium and on the pitch?
Yeah, it was amazing. I mean, you were first, of course, drawn to the players and the sort of the crowd of staff and players that jump out of the dugout. Then you're looking at the south stand and people hugging, random strangers, limbs everywhere. It was so enjoyable watching the chaos. It was like a little piece of art where you could see something different every time you watch back the goal. Look, it was probably as well the loudest I've ever heard the stadium. And I think everybody walking up the high road, going into the stadium. Me and you went down to the south stand after the stadium to be amongst the fans, and everything just felt great.
And you kind of felt like you needed to go and just need to be in
just
it.
Just drink
you?
It in you a little bit, yeah. And I think that's the thing. It was touched upon this week by Daniel Levy. You know, you just cannot wait for the next game. So it's felt like a long 8 days. It's going to feel like a long 8 days by the time kickoff comes around on Sunday.
Absolutely. And it wasn't just in the stadium. I mean, I'm sure you've seen this as well, but all over the world, this is DC Spurs. Look at the reaction there. This is it's only really football that can do this kind of thing to you, isn't it?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, you can only get, 62,000? I mean, it's a big stadium, but you can get 62,000 people in the stadium. Everyone else has to just watch from afar. And seeing those clips, I love those things. Like, it really reminds me of all those clips I watched off the back of Lucas Moura's win it against Ajax, like Bergwijn's double against Leicester. People in their living rooms, like, just knocking over the telly and family members celebrating and stuff like that. It was yeah, great to see that as
well. Loved it. And huge shout out to our official supporter clubs all over the world that I know will have been soaking that one up wherever you are. I hope you absolutely loved it. So an amazing result and some brilliant news for us last weekend. Some really sad news for us and for Ivan Perisic this week. He suffered a serious injury that means he's going to be out for an extended period. It's a huge loss and a real shame for Ivan as well, Rob.
Yeah, I mean, he was proving to be such a useful member of the squad, and he is a creator. You know, he got more assists than any other player last season, 12. In his minutes off the bench this season, he got a couple. He got one against Fulham and a brilliant delivery from Richarlison. No one else really seems to have that level of delivery, that just always on the money. He's up against a fullback, will check in and get something in. Professional, so experienced, won multiple titles in multiple countries. He is a loss and a weapon off the bench. And I think he sort of was reborn a little bit playing back on the left wing in the 4-3-3. But if there's one position where I feel Spurs are stocked, it's left wing. So Sonny and Solomon, of course, have done the role this season. Brennan Johnson, Richarlison can both play there as well. And then we're still waiting for Brian Hill and Ryan Sessegnon to come back from injury. Both know that position. You know, if there's one area of the pitch Spurs are stocked, I think it's on the left side of that front three.
Absolutely. And we wish Ivan a speedy recovery. I hope it is as smooth as it can possibly be for you, Ivan. Let's talk through the fixtures that are coming up this weekend. Spurs playing on Sunday afternoon, but it's a packed Premier League schedule in terms of the Sunday afternoon. Split of the games 5-5 this week.
Yeah, of course, teams have been playing in the Europa League Conference League, so we've got this heavy loaded Sunday. Of course, you're looking at Manchester City. They've won all five games at home to Nottingham Forest. On Saturday, you'd expect them to go and win that game, despite the fact Forest have had a decent start to the Premier League, competed well with Arsenal and Man United in their two games. But then I'm also looking at Liverpool, kicking off at the same time as the North London Derby, playing West Ham. That's who Spurs play next week. Liverpool have also got a Carabao Cup game in the week. You'd expect, like, the Europa League, they're going to heavily rotate. So whatever team Klopp puts out at the weekend, you expect to be something close to what we're going to see in N17 next week.
One of the joys, though, of this and looking at the table as well, fans will now be looking and being like, what are those teams, Man City, Liverpool, doing around
exactly,
us?
Yeah.
Because Spurs are right in there.
They are, yeah. You look at the league table already, and we're allowed to look at it now because we're five games in and it really means something
exactly.
Now. And it certainly means something when Spurs are second in the table. City, the only team unbeaten so far, but look at that. You've got Spurs, Liverpool, Arsenal, the teams you'd expect to be competing around the Champions League places, all unbeaten, all on 13 points. And that's what makes the North London derby even more tantalising this weekend.
And that goal difference as well. It tells you Spurs are out there. And
I'm
attacking.
Looking at goal difference after the fifth game of the season.
Yes,
that's how excited I am by the league table.
I'm like Maldi, I want to use it as proof that Spurs are out there and taking the game to teams.
Great point, absolutely.
Love. And it's been a brilliant week, and it's been a brilliant, actually, few months for us, really. And one of the things, one of the key parts of why it's been so special is watching Angie in the media. It's fast becoming fans' highlight of the week outside of the game. So here he is at Hotspur Way, facing the media, starting with that all-important team news for this weekend.
Disappointing, firstly for Ivan more than anything else. Yeah, it's just one of those innocuous things that'll happen sometimes. He obviously got a pretty significant injury from training, and as I said, disappointed for him because, I mean, I've only worked with him for a little while, but you can see why. You know, he's played at some of the biggest clubs in the world and why he's maintained such a level of performance for so many years. He's the ultimate pro in the way he trains, the way he presents himself. And it's disappointing for us as well because, you know, he's been a real important part of sort of what we've done so far. We don't have a great experience in the group, and he's one that, you know, does have that level head, and he's been pretty significant in all our games so far in big moments. So I said, first, disappointed for him, disappointed for us in terms of, you know, what we're trying to build. But, you know, he's, as I said at the start, he's very strong-willed, and I've got no doubt he'll come back and you know, for club and country, and get back to the levels he showed before getting injured.
Huge game Sunday, and you've been involved in so many derby matches in your time, most recently Celtic and Rangers. Over the last few months, obviously, locally, Foster's, Hadley Wood, you've bumped into Spurs fans, and maybe even Arsenal fans have told you just how big a game this is for both sets of fans.
Yeah, no, it's fair to say, people have sort of given me an indication of how they feel about this game, and that's great. I mean, it's, as you said, I've been involved in derbies, and one very significant one, and you understand what it means to supporters for both clubs and kind of the significance in terms of the general mood around the place. So all these kind of things add significance to the fixture, and also the fact that, you know, they're a very, very good football side. They had an outstanding season last year. I think they've strengthened this year. They're a group that's, for the most part, has grown together, and you can see that, you know, there's a real belief within them. So, playing them at their place is going to be a hell of a challenge for us.
Lovely to hear from Ange there, and I'm sure it's the same for you guys. Every single week now, I'm looking forward to seeing him speaking in the press conferences, speaking to fans, interacting with fans. He was brilliant in the fans forum this week. He's having such an impact both on and off the pitch, Rob.
Well, there was that brilliant moment when we spoke to Kulusevski after the last game where he spoke about how calm Postecoglou is, and that's emanating, I think, out on his players a little bit. But then also he's extremely authentic. You know, he's always got something interesting to say. And you can imagine, like, having a beer with him down the high road or something, you know, after a game. And he also really seems to understand football fan culture and the relationship between the fans and the club. And he is saying all the right things right now.
What about on the pitch? Talk me through it. Where are we seeing an impact and where are we seeing a difference?
Well, you know, anecdotally, you can obviously see just how much better Spurs are week in, week out. But you can see it in the numbers as well now. The team's scoring on a more regular basis, creating a better quality of chance. Shots are up by basically 50%. And it is about that time that's being spent in the opposition half and final third that is really so interesting. I mean, I think we've seen it a lot. The team in recent years has been trying to be explosive in transition on the counter-attack. Now, Postecoglou Spurs are trying to control games. And that's what we've seen in the opening five.
Yeah, there's ways to win games, isn't there? And I have to say, I'm adoring the way that we're winning games.
Absolutely.
At the moment.
Yeah.
And I wonder what the fans think. We're going to bring in Paul Pavley from Yorkshire Spurs now. Paul, I'm so eager to hear what you've made of this start under Ange. How's it been for you?
Oh, it's just been amazing, hasn't it? It's just been a breath of fresh air. It's just the way we've been playing, everything he's been saying. I was at the fan forum on Tuesday, and it's just amazing to hear. It's just a breath of fresh air, as I say.
So how was the fans forum? I mean, I thought he came across wonderfully in that.
Yeah, he came across really, really nice and down to earth, and just really, really the way he communicated with everyone that asked questions. He was just straight with them. It was everything he said was just what we wanted to hear, you know. Just nice and simple. I really liked what he done at the end with Owen, the little boy, which was amazing. So shout out to Owen as well on that one. Just everything's just is just going so well at the moment. Hopefully it we can build on it on Sunday against Arsenal.
Well, let's get to this then. How do you feel in the week running up to a North London derby?
I don't like it at all. It's one of those games. You always look at the fixtures when they come out, and it's one of the first ones you look at. Well, the home one's the first one you look at, then the away against Arsenal. But then you never really look forward to it, building up to it. I think it's going to be a tough one. But yeah, as what Ange said and what Sonny said at the fan forum, you know, he just said everyone's running for each other. They run through brick walls for each other. No one wants to play us at the moment. So yeah, we're just going to have to go there and just. I think Ange said today that he's not going to change his way in how they're going to play. They're just going to go and attack, and hopefully we can get a result of some sort.
Paul, I'm so glad. That makes me feel so much better for feeling nervous, because Rob and I have been speaking about this for the last few days, and I am always ahead of North London derbies. I can't help it. It does something to me that no other game does. Is it the same for you?
No, if I'm not there, I'm a nervous wreck anyway. If I'm there or if I'm watching it at home, I just bite my nails off sometimes. I can't even watch the TV if I'm not at a game. And even the 3-0 game that we've done at the Tottenham Hotspur Stadium, that was probably the least stressful in the last sort of 25 years, I think, because we sort of had that game under control, but still a bit of doubt towards the end. But you just never know what's going to happen. But yeah, always a stressful occasion.
Yeah, just tell us, Paul, where will you be watching the game this weekend? And Yorkshire Spurs, what will they be doing for this one?
So I'm going to be watching it with Yorkshire Spurs with for the North London derby, the away game. We always... we've got an area booked in a sports bar in Yorkshire, so there'll be a massive turnout for that. It's a really popular game. There's a lot of us can't get tickets for that fixture, so it's always a popular one to watch. With you know, there'll be a load of us. There'll be sort of 40 or 50 of us watching it in a pub.
Amazing!
So yeah, we'll all be together. Yeah, it'll be good.
Sorry to do this to you. What's the score going to be?
I knew you were going to ask that.
Sorry, I'm sorry.
like anyone, you hope for a win, but you take a draw. That's as far as I'll probably say, to be honest.
Bag on the money.
2-0. I'll go 2-0.
Yeah, well, yeah, look, 2-0. Enjoy it as much as you can, Paul. And I hope. I know with North London Derby, basically the only time you can enjoy it is at when the whistle goes at the 90th minute. But I hope that you get something from it and you get to enjoy sitting all together and watch it at the bar.
No, definitely we will be.
Amazing. Such a pleasure. Thank you so much, Paul.
No, cheers.
Amazing. Well, look, Paul's pretty much mentioned it there, but when we play at the Emirates, the feeling is so, so different. So we're going to throw it back into the archive and look at one of our classic wins there, an absolute belter of a game from 2010-2011.
Arsenal against Tottenham needs no further introduction. Hear the noise. Fabregas, fabulous ball, Najri, that's round the keeper, and in! Sensational finish from an impossible angle! Here's Arshavin, aimed it at Shamak, 2! Tommaso Okoto, stolen on by Defoe, pursued by Van der Vaart, and played in for Gareth Bale! Tottenham back in it! It is Van der Vaart. Hit the wall, handball, penalty. Raphael Van der Vaart, 2-2. It's quite a game, isn't it always? In by Van der Vaart, on by Cabal. 2-0 down, 3-2 up. Spurs at Arsenal. Truly a glory, glory day for Tottenham Hotspur. One of the great turnarounds in the rich history of the North London derby.
What an incredible performance that was, and what an era that was for Spurs as well. 13 years since that game, and I'm interested, Rob, how are we going to break Arsenal down this time?
I don't know the answer to that, Ben, but I think there are some key battles in the game. I think of Destiny Udogie versus Bukayo Saka. I think of the way of Declan Rice will try and marshal James Maddison. I think of Heung-Min Son playing as the striker, using his hold-up play. He's got that in his locker. That's what I've really liked about him as the centre-forward. And also then him in behind that Arsenal high line, maybe a bit like that Pedro Porro to Son Burnley goal is a way to hurt Arsenal on Sunday.
It feels like there are a couple of key players that are going to have a massive impact on the game. You've picked out Yves Bissouma. Tell me why.
Well, I think pound for pound, he's been my Tottenham Hotspur player of the season, Yves Bissouma. He's been absolutely outstanding, rejuvenated in this Ange Postecoglou side. And he is so pivotal to the way this team play, because there's a lot of risk in there. There's a lot of looking to play the ball into midfield. But the guy is basically press resistant. It's near impossible to win the ball off him, even in that ridiculous scenario.
What a touch.
And the other thing, oh, what a touch. And he's also got this sort of box of tricks, lots of different things he can use to his strengths. Like, he's physical, he's got that ability to hold off a player, but he's got a step over, he's got a lovely little flick up his sleeve as well. I think he's just been absolutely outstanding in that position and the perfect player for Ange Postecoglou.
Ball does seem to be like glue to his feet, doesn't it? It's very, very interesting that he'll get into these little back and forths with someone in the midfield. He seems to always come out with the ball at his feet.
And he seems to enjoy it. So if you do try and press him, and Arsenal will, it's going to be a key battle in that area. He just breezes away from players and he doesn't even seem to look up to see if someone's charging him down. He knows how to break away from opposition players. In fairness, it's a trait that Rodrigo Bentancur's got too, and I'm sure that first goal's not far away for Tottenham Hotspur. He's come close. That would have been an unbelievable goal against Sheffield United.
Wouldn't it? Yeah. One of the things I think that he's added as well that we perhaps knew that he was good at, but he's gone on another level, is that ability to open up play as well, as you were sort of talking about there. The fact that he has this range of passing maybe that we weren't totally across before. It's wonderful to watch.
He's such a complete midfield player. And I think we're seeing all these things that we saw when Spurs signing from Brighton. There was such excitement when he arrived. Heaven knows what he'd be worth now. He just has so many different skills. His passing range is absolutely superb. He isn't just playing short, simple little passes into teammates. He's playing these raking balls out to the wingers. Wingers are nice high and tight up the pitch. He's trying to find them out wide. It's been a joy to watch so far.
Now, this is not necessarily a head-to-head battle in the sense that the two players are going to come up against each other loads of in the game. Mm. But Declan Rice versus Yves Bissouma does feel like whoever can be more efficient in their role at the weekend can really drive their team forward and potentially be the difference maker.
Well, the Premier League is blessed with players in this position right now. You think of Rodri at Manchester City, but Rice and Bissouma are right up there for me too. And look at them, there's a real similar profile to both players. You look at their pass completion, you look at their touches, near identical in the opening five Premier League games of the season. But what Bissouma is better at, for sure, is driving a possession. He's had more successful dribbles than Declan Rice, greater success when he does try them. And look at this as well. This will be key for me in trying to deal with the threat of Martin Odegaard. Outstanding the other night in that number 10 position for Arsenal against PSV in the Champions League. He's winning the ball back more than Rice. He's recovering it more than Rice. He's been unbelievable. Yes, he might not be as much of a goal threat as Declan Rice. He doesn't get loads himself, but I think this is where Bissouma would be a superior player, turning over the ball from the opposition.
Can we talk about that stat at the top as well? I mean, to have two players that are both very progressive in terms of the way that they play, both looking to get on the score sheet, both looking to make aggressive forward passes, to have a pass completion rate of 90%, it's phenomenal.
It's ridiculous because they are playing risky passes. You sort of think about that risk-reward element to the way that both Arsenal and Spurs want to play. But Bissouma's hitting them right now and I don't see it stopping.
Both sides will look to play from the back. Both sides will look to play through the thirds. That means that the defence will be crucial, not just from a point of keeping the ball out of the net, but from a point of view that they need to create attacks and create momentum. Kuti Romero is someone that you're desperate to see have a good game this weekend. Has been brilliant so far.
Absolutely right. We think about Yves Bissouma being press-resistant in terms of taking the ball on the half-turn. Romero is looking across the whole pitch, and he's not afraid to wait for players to come onto him. But that out-ball to James Maddison in particular has been so good this season. He isn't afraid to play those risky passes into midfield, and it isn't just about belief in his own passing. It's belief he has the quality of player, like Pedro Porro here, to do something really clever. This was brilliant, by the way, from Pedro Porro. And I'm sure that Mickey van der Ven's looking at Kuti Romero to his right and saying, right, this is the standard of pass. I've got to play in midfield. And have belief that someone like Pedro Porro can do that as well. And look at our final clip as well. This is his favourite ball. Into Maddison, between midfield and defence, between the lines. This is how James Maddison gets involved, and that eventually led to the winning goal against United at the weekend.
And there seems to be a level of comfort that Kuti Romero has on the ball that he doesn't really mind being pressed. He's quite happy for opponents to come and press him because it can open up options in front
of him. Exactly. It will open up space for midfield. And if Lionel Messi says he's the best central defender in the world, yeah. I'm not going to argue with him.
There is no way that we're going to disagree. Look, we're going to speak to Yves Bissouma very shortly. I can't wait to chat to him about the season that he's had so far. But why not remind ourselves of what season it's been for Spurs over the course of the first five games?
Madison. Did keep it. Emerson Royale, brilliant goal! Where did that come from? He breezes into the penalty area here. Saar! With his biggest moment yet for Tottenham Hotspur. Nice 1-2 with Son. And the cutback is perfect. And the finish is two. A first of the season for Dejan Kulusevski.
Porro instantly looking for Son. It's Son Heung-min for Spurs to score his hat-trick.
Crowd's up. Spurs are up. Richarlison. Kulusevski with him. Kulusevski! He's done it!
What an incredible journey it's been over the last couple of months. Some amazing performances in there and some unbelievably good performers as well. And we've got one of them with us now. Yves Bissouma, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you too.
Tell me firstly, how much are you enjoying being a part of this Spurs side at the May?
Well, to be honest, I'm really happy. You know, I'm really happy to be part of this this club because I know everyone knows it's an amazing club and big as well with big ambition, you know. That's why I signed here, and yeah, we're gonna try to find something in the future for the club.
It's been fascinating hearing Ange talk about you, Yves, because you've come back from the injuries of last season. You're playing so well this season under the new head coach. He says all the praise should go your way, that you've done it. You've had this brilliant turnaround. You're playing amazing. But what can you say about what Ange Postecoglou's done for you?
To be honest, he's the way I said, he's like a dad for, not just for me, but for all of the players, you know, because he talk with his players, he's try to make you understand what he really want to do, you know, and that's really good and it's really important for us as a footballer. And for me, personally, he talk with me a lot, you know, he said to me how he want me to be, you know, for the team and for me as well. So I'm just trying to listen to him and try to work hard to show him like I can do what I want. And yeah, now we're very good. We're winning games and yeah, I'm really happy and he's happy as well. And all of us just say like, it's not just me, it's a group, you know, we work as a group. So yeah, everyone's happy and yeah, we have to continue like that.
So you're playing Arsenal this weekend, a team that like to press aggressively. And one of my favourite things watching you is how difficult it is to get the ball off you. That you seem impossible to press, back to goal, you'll turn out of situations. Can you tell us what it's like to be under that kind of pressure and players trying to win the ball off you in midfield?
First of all, you know, me, when I play football, I enjoy. I just enjoy. I enjoy to play football because, yeah, for me to be on the pitch, and play Premier League, that's mean like it's great for me because I'm in one of the best league in the world, and then yeah after I work for I don't know how many years to have my way to play, you know, and I try to continue on this way. And when I was young, I was really watching Yaya Toure as well. I was watching him a lot, and I learned a lot from him. But I know I can do more. So yeah, I just walk and I have my way to play and yeah.
Is it nice watching back some of these clips? I mean, you're playing so well, Yves, at the moment. Like, what are you putting this down to? This amazing form that you're in.
I think it's just confidence the coach gave me, because to be honest, from the first day to now, the confidence he's gave me is unbelievable. You know, it's amazing. I was watching for this confidence, I don't know how many times, you know. But yeah, he came, we have a good conversation. And from that, I know straight what I have to do on the pitch.
I love that. And I've got to say, Spurs fans are getting so much joy from watching your performances this season. And one of the comparisons that I see a lot, people talk about Moussa Dembélé. Do you remember watching clips of Moussa Dembélé and seeing him?
Yeah.
How nice is it for you to have that comparison? Because no one could get the ball off Moussa then.
Yeah, I know. Moussa is, to be honest, yeah, I didn't watch him a lot, but the game I watch, what a player. What a player, big player, and he deserves a lot of respect, you know. I know, especially for Tottenham, because yeah, he was here, all the fans like him a lot. But yeah, I think it's too early to compare myself to Moussa, because yeah, Moussa is Moussa, everyone know. I'm just following my way, and I hope to be better than him in the future. But I'm just staying focused on me and Tottenham. That's the most important for me.
I love that. Last one for you, Eve, yeah. Before we let you go. I loved your post on Instagram after the game, after the Sheffield United game, yeah. Because I could feel your joy, yeah, and your happiness. Mm-hmm. Talk us through how it felt at the end of that game. I see you amongst the players leading everyone towards the south, yeah, stand. Yeah. Talk us through that feeling. How special was that for you?
No, to be honest, you know, As a player, as a footballer, you know, I really like the feeling like this, you know, because it's not just us, but all the stadium push us, you know, to win this game. That's why I said on my social media, especially on my Instagram, I said just the victory is for the fans, you know. It's for the fans, for all of people who come on the stadium and was watching this game. And, you know, for me, I respect Sheffield. It's a good club. Very good team, but I respect them. But for me, it wasn't possible to lose this game, you know, because we control all the game. We create, I don't know how many chances to score, but we didn't. And the first shot or second, the score, you know, for me, it wasn't acceptable to lose the game. So I tried to push my teammate. All of us tried to push each other, and especially the fans. Yeah, the stadium was unbelievable. That's why while the game is finished, and I watch. All of the stadium, I was like, wow. I realize now, yeah. I'm just, you know, because me, I'm putting myself so far, you know. I just realized, like, imagine we win the league, imagine this, you know. So I was like, nah, we have to continue on this way, because it's the best way when you play and you win. Especially the game like this in the last minute, you score 2 goals, it's amazing. So yeah, thank you for the fans and for everyone who comes support us. Yeah.
Eve, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you. Good luck this weekend. Fingers crossed. It's another big 3 points for you guys, and hopefully another amazing performance for you as well.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, of course. We're gonna try to win this game. You know, it's not easy game, especially when you play North London Derby. You know, but I think it will be a good game. And yeah, the best gonna win. But I know we're gonna go there to try to win. After it's Premier League, everyone know how Premier League is. It's really tough. So yeah, we're ready for that. And yeah, we're watching the moment.
We got everything crossed for you. Thank you so much, Eve.
Yeah, thank you.
So thank you so much once again to Eve for joining us. Rob, before we finish, and I'm sorry to do this to you, but I have to ask you.
I know what you're gonna do.
How's it gonna play out? What's your score prediction gonna be?
I think it's going to be 2-2, actually. I think Spurs is going to go there and get a point. And I think Spurs, we've seen from what Ange Postecoglou's been saying, I think they're going to play their way, stick to the philosophies that we've seen from the opening 5 matches and really compete with Arsenal. Like, Arsenal had a great result the other night. They haven't been at their fluent best in the league. I thought it'd be phases where Spurs are on top, Arsenal are on top. So I think I'm going to go 2-2.
Can I tell you who I think is going to score?
Absolutely.
Because I'll agree with you. I think it's going to be 2-2 as well.
Yeah?
Like, I am too much of a Spurs fan to sit here and say, like, we're going to walk it. You know, I think it might be a draw. But if I had to pick two people to score in a North London derby, one of them needs to be Richarlison, because he does celebrating in a derby like nobody else. And one of them needs to be James Maddison as well, because he's now celebrating and why don't you like nobody else? So I'll absolutely take that.
Absolutely right.
Rob, it's been such a pleasure. Thank
Cheers,
you so much
Ben.
For joining.
Great fun.
And thank you so much for watching at home as well. Just a little reminder, you can get the review show after the game on Sunday. Me and Stephen Kelly will be running through all of the highlights and all of the action there. And fingers crossed, Spurs go and get a massive 3 points. And then you want to relive the full 90 minutes. And you can do that on Spurs Play from midnight onwards. So you get the full 90 minutes on there for you to go back through and enjoy and pick out every last detail if you want to. That's Spurs Play from midnight onwards. So thanks again for joining us. It's been such a pleasure to share this one for you. And good luck to the boys this Sunday. Come on, you Spurs.